Good morning, Grace. We're so happy that you're here. It's Baptism Sunday. We are so excited. Let's worship together. Let's stand on our feet. Show the Lord all of our appreciation.
Our lives, our hearts, our hands, we're reaching out to see.
Registered in heaven, I believe in science. may have a seat. You may have a seat.
All right. So good to see you all today. There's a lot of energy in this room. Man, y'all are into it today. I love it. So cool. Well, hey, we are celebrating baptisms today. I think we've already baptized, what, nine people so far this morning. So it has been awesome. You know, yeah. You know that we love celebrating baptism here at this church because of the sign of what God is doing in people's lives, and it's a sign of what he's doing in our church. So this is a celebration, and so we are going to get the celebration started. So first, we got Valerie Brown coming down to be baptized. Come on, Valerie.
Stand up here in the front.
So Valerie said that she placed her faith in Jesus when she was a young girl, and she is getting baptized today. Even though she was baptized as a child, she wants to get baptized today to be rebaptized as a way to honor God and kind of show where she is in life right now. So this is really cool.
Valerie, we put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you. I believe you, my sister. It is my honor to baptize you today in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bear with the Christ in baptism. Grace to walk in new life.
Awesome. All right. We love when these kind of things happen. Valerie is now going to baptize her son, Asher. So come on up, Asher. Come on up, Asher. All right. So Asher said he, is that hot? All right. Well, he accepted Jesus when he was little. He said his mommy helped him to make that decision. And he's getting baptized today because he said, I helped four kids accept Christ. And I want everyone to know I love God. Really cool, man. Let's do it, Asher.
All right. Asher, have you put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you?
Yes.
All right, I believe you, my brother. It is your mom's honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bear with Christ in baptism. Grace to walk in new life.
So cool. I love it. All right, now we've got Brody Romines. Come on, Brody. And Brody's going to get baptized by his dad, Cody, today. So this is really neat too. And he said that he placed his faith in Jesus right here at Grace Fellowship Church. And he said he's simply getting baptized today to serve and follow Jesus.
All right, Cody, have you put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you?
Yes.
All right, brother, it's your dad's honor to baptize you this morning in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in new life.
Next, we have Michaela Klein. Come on, Michaela. And it looks like, Bill, are you baptizing her this morning? All right, another dad baptizing his daughter. This is so cool. She placed her faith in Jesus at Camp Zephyr, which was our church camp this summer. And mom and dad helped her make that decision, and Pastor Gabe. And she says she's being baptized today to follow Jesus and show others that she wants to be a testimony for Jesus. Perfect.
All right, Michaela, have you put your faith and trust in Jesus to save you?
Yes.
All right. It is your dad's honor to baptize you this morning in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bear with Christ in baptism. Grace to walk in new life.
Love it. All right. Now we've got Tred Worthington. Tred, come on. Tred's coming up with his parents, Shauna and DC, and Tred said he placed his faith in Jesus in July of 2019. He said he did it in his mom and dad's room, talking to them. So mom and dad helped him make the decision. And he said, I'm doing this to let all people know that I follow Jesus. I love it. All right, and his dad, DC, is going to baptize him.
Tred, have you placed your faith in Jesus to save you? Then it is your dad's privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear with Christ in baptism. Grace to walk in new life.
All right, and now we have Dallas Seidel. Come on, Dallas. Come on, Dallas. You're usually more excited than that. Let's get excited, buddy. All right. So he placed his faith in Jesus at Camp Zephyr last summer, and he made the decision in the tabernacle with Pastor Gabe and with his parents. And Dallas is getting baptized today to show that I have Jesus in my heart.
I've watched this little boy grow up. Dallas, it's my privilege. I need to ask you a question first. Can I ask you a question? Have you placed your faith in Jesus to save you? You have. That's awesome. Thank you for letting me do this. Dallas, it's my privilege to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Grace to walk in a new life.
All right. Man, it is so fun to celebrate baptism together. You know, when somebody gets baptized, it's a celebration for them personally. It's a celebration for their family, but it's also a celebration for us as a church because, again, it shows that God is moving and God is doing things and he is changing lives. And so it's always so special. Hey, Heavenly Father, thank you for each one of these people who have placed their faith in you. And today, they went public with their faith by telling the world that they're in that relationship simply by this act of obedience and this celebration of baptism. God, thank you for letting us be part of it. And God, we're just going to ask you, keep bringing more and more people to you and let us celebrate with them and with you in that decision. God, we love you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, let's get on our feet in the note of celebration and let's keep singing.
Let's continue to tell of God's wonderful mercies and wonderful grace and his power today. Let's sing together.
I've heard stories that have proved your faithfulness. I've seen miracles my mind can comprehend. There is beauty in what I can understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you.
Thank you.
can we deny your power? How can we deny your presence? How can we deny life change, God, when we hear it firsthand? And we've celebrated all day. Hearts be open today to your move and to who you are, and for reminding us that you are a powerful God. We love you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Well, once again, welcome to Grace Fellowship. We're glad you're here today. We're especially glad you're here on a day when we get to celebrate baptism. I think that's really cool. I'm going to ask you to do something. All of you, take out your cell phone, your mobile device, your smartphone, whatever you call that, your mobile, whatever you call that thing. Pull that out, scan the QR code on the seat back pocket in front of you. There's going to be something for each and every one of you to do through that QR code. And for those who just stare at me and look at me, that's fine. Okay. All right. We're going to talk about identity today, so I'll be okay. All right. Hey, here's what we're doing. We're really glad you're here. And if you're a first-time guest here today, or maybe you're fairly new to the church and you've just never let us know you're here, we would love for you to scan that QR code and click on New Here is the link that you can click on. If you're watching online, thank you for joining us online. You'll have all of these links in your chat box there also. But if you're new, click that new here, and it asks for just a couple pieces of information. It's actually, we give you a test. It's a really hard test. I've never had anybody fail it. It asks your name, and it asks for your phone number. Pretty good. Although it's hard to remember your phone number sometimes, but you can do it. You can pass it. So go ahead and fill that out. It takes just a few seconds. And what that does is lets you connect with the church, and it lets us connect with you. And we're not going to bother you with it or do anything weird with it. All we want to do is give you some information to help you take next steps here at Grace Fellowship when and if you're ready to do that, okay? So we would love for you to click on that link if you're new here. The other link that's for all of us is the link that says Give Now. And so as we think about that or this moment right now, what I want to talk to you about today is generosity, okay? And generosity is this idea that it should come out of the overflow of our relationship with God and out of the overflow of our heart. And so it's so easy when you're at a church like this and you see God moving and you see God doing all kinds of things and kids need to go to camp and we need to build a building and people are getting baptized and you go, well, okay, I'll give to that, right? And that's great. It takes money to do all those things. That's great. However, that's transactional giving, right? That's not necessarily generosity, right? So generosity, here's what generosity is. Generosity is a physical, tangible statement saying, God, I trust you. God, I believe that you are my source. Nothing else is my source, right? And that's what we're telling God when we are generous. I trust you, and I believe that you will provide for me all that I need. And in fact, we're saying, I believe that everything that I already have belongs to you, and I'm just giving a small portion back to say thank you. And see, that just overflows out of that relationship, recognizing that he is with you always and he's your provider. He is your source. That's generosity. And so I just want to challenge us to be a church that is filled with that kind of spirit, with that kind of attitude when it comes to giving. In fact, the Bible calls that being a hilarious or a cheerful giver. See, I can give cheerfully because I'm not afraid of letting go of something. See, that's the battle to generosity, or that's the thing that keeps us from being generous most of the time is fear. Because if I let go of it, I might need that. I worked hard for that. I don't want to let go of it. And see, fear is what counters what that step of faith. And so the Bible is full of all kinds of warnings about do not fear. Do not be afraid. And so I just want to challenge you when it comes to generosity, be a cheerful giver and do not let fear get in your way. All right. So today you can give by scanning that QR code, clicking on Give Now. Or if you want to give in person, you can drop your gift, check, cash, whatever, in the generosity boxes throughout the church. And I just want to say thank you for being a very generous church. You really are. All right. Well, Chris is coming up in just a moment, and he is kicking off a great new series called Identity. And this is absolutely my favorite topic. Ask anybody that knows me very well, or come talk to me for about 5 minutes and we'll end up in a discussion about identity. But this is important. And so here's what I want you to do. Another thing you can do, scan that QR code, click on sermon notes, get ready to take some notes about what God wants to say to you while Pastor Chris delivers this message today. And so let's get ready for Chris to come up and give us a great message.
Well, it's a great day to be here, don't you think? Yeah. Yeah, I'm grateful to be here with you. My name's Chris. I'm the lead pastor here at Grace, and if I haven't met you yet, I would love to, and I'd love for you to get connected right here at Grace. I'm so excited about what God's doing, that we get to be a part of it. I'm excited about what he has for us today. If you're new to the God thing, or maybe you're here because you're forced to come, it doesn't matter. Maybe you're just checking out the God thing. You're not sure what you believe. I want you to know you're in the right place. We're excited that you're here. I hope this is a place where you can journey in faith and experience God for yourself and experience his truth in your life in a way that has changed my life and changed so many of ours. I believe that he can change yours as well. Today, we are starting a new series about identity. And I love this because when I meet with people and talk with people about what's going on and struggles and things, so often the very thing that they're struggling with at the root of it, at the core of it, so often is simply an identity issue. I know this was true for me for so many years of my life. So I'm excited to dive into this together. But before we get started, let's pray and ask God to speak to us in this time. God, will you move in this place? Holy Spirit, speak. Will you open our hearts and our minds to your truth? Open eyes to your truth. Draw people to yourself today, and that your truth would transform the way we think and the way that we live. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, growing up, my dad would give us a reminder every time before he dropped us off or before we left, once we started driving, he would say this. He would say, just remember who you are and whose you are. And what he meant by that is, remember, you're a Hurst and you belong to God, because he knew this to be true, is that who I believed myself, where I found my identity, who I was and who I belonged to would impact the decisions that I make. It would impact the way that I live my life, because he knew something that's true, that if we're honest, we start seeing this in our own life, is that where we find our identity is where we find our worth. That's where we find our value. And so we will chase worth and we will chase value in the things that we believe will bring us identity. So the question is, how do we figure out our real identity? How do we discover what our real identity is? And I would want for us to maybe think about it this way for a minute, is that my wife several years ago had a custom cake business. It was awesome. I loved it because she would make the cakes and her homemade buttercream icing. It was so good. I would eat it by the spoonfuls. If she was still doing it today, I would be 500 pounds. But it was amazing. I tasted everything and it was great. And she would make all kinds of cakes. Some would be like a watermelon cake that was for a birthday party one time, and it was great. Cut it open, it was kind of watermelon color inside. And then there was this one she made for my son, was a dinosaur cake. She carved it into a dinosaur. And then my dad one time, because he's all about space, he wanted a spaceship, and we put candles in the back to make it look like it was taking off. He said he wanted a spaceship landing on an American flag. And so that's what he did. That's what she did. It was awesome. It was amazing. And some of these cakes, you can look and be like, oh, that's what that is. But then there's other cakes that you look at and go, all right, what is that supposed to be? It looks like just a cake. What is it for? It could be a birthday. It could be a wedding. It could be, a shower. How do you know what it was created to be? Well, the only way to know what the cake was created to be and its value was to ask the one who created it. And the same is true for you and for me, that we were created on purpose and for a purpose. And the only way for us to really understand our real identity and our real value is go to the one who created us. Now, the thing is, we have a real spiritual enemy, and he understands this concept of identity driving the way we live our life, too. And his desire is to steal, kill, and destroy everything that God made good. He wants to destroy our lives, and Jesus calls him the chief liar, all right? He's the father of all lies, a deceiver. And what he wants us to do is he wants us to begin to believe a lie about ourselves or a lie that forms what we believe about ourselves, because he truly understands the same thing that my dad understood, that what we believe to be true will influence what we do. What we believe to be true about ourselves will influence the way that we live our lives, the decisions that we make along the way, and what we believe to be true about what God created us for, or even if we are able to experience what God created us for. And what happens is we begin making decisions that become self-fulfilling prophecies, because this is what we believe about ourselves, it's just who I am. So we make these decisions and just confirm these false thoughts and false beliefs that the enemy uses to steal our identity. So today we're going to start looking at a few of those false beliefs. And the one we're starting with today is one that I struggled with for years. And it wasn't until I was 35 years old that God began to bring it to light. And I came to discover that, man, you've believed a lie for far too long. And I've been in ministry for years. I mean, you'd think I'd have it figured out by now. And it was a lie that I struggled with, because you know what I like to say? I grew up in the middle, all right? Middle class, middle child, middle of the day, all right? But I had a great family. My parents loved God, loved each other. They were both leaders, very successful in what they did, a great reputation in the town. They loved us and taught us how to love Jesus. I mean, it was amazing. But I also had an older brother who's 15 months older than me, and we couldn't be any more different, all right? We were night and day different. I'm, you know, just the opposite on all spectrums, but he was very successful in what he did. Then I have a little sister who's 3 years younger than me, and she's perfect at everything, all right? You know those people, right? She was an athlete. She played college basketball. She was salutatorian in high school. She was valedictorian in college while she was captain of the basketball team and student body president. Yeah, she's one of those. And it's one thing to feel like you're growing up in your brother's shadow. It's another thing when your little sister's shadow begins creeping up on you. And here's the thing. My parents were amazing parents. They did an amazing job raising us. I don't think that they could have loved me any less or any more. I mean, it was one of those things that they did an amazing job. And my struggle with identity didn't come from anything they did wrong. It came from the fact that there's a real enemy who took the differences and began to tell me that they were deficiencies. And he does that in all of our lives. He points out the ways that we're different and the ways that maybe someone else is better at this than us, or we didn't do this or whatever. And he begins to tell us that those differences are actually deficiencies. And for me, there was this internal voice always telling me, you're not good enough. Or actually what he says it in first person and gets us to buy into it. I'm not good enough. So today we're going to look at this lie, I'm not good enough, because I know that many people in here today, you've struggled with this in the past, and many people, you are struggling with it today, and maybe you don't even realize it yet. But you struggle with this lie of I'm not good enough, and because for several reasons. For some, it's because we find our identity in what people say. Maybe you grew up in a great home and you had great encouragement like I did, but I know that's not everyone. Maybe for you, you grew up in a home where you heard things like you're stupid and you're no good and you're pathetic and I wish I never had you and you can never do anything right. I had a student one time, we were talking about honoring your father and mother, and he came and talked to me. He said, do I have to honor my dad even though he hates me? And I was like, your dad doesn't hate you, all right? And no dad hates their son. And I was like, he said, no, my dad hates me. I said, well, how do you know? He said, because he tells me he does. And maybe you came from a place where you constantly had these negative messages from a parent or from others in your life constantly beating you down. And you began to believe what they were saying and thinking, well, maybe they're right. Maybe I'm not good enough. Or maybe for you it's an image thing. You had someone tell you along the way, if you just lose a little weight, you'd be a lot more pretty. And so for your whole life, you felt like, man, I'm just not skinny enough. I'm not ripped enough. I'm not healthy enough. I'm just not enough. And you began to believe the lie that I'm not good enough because of what someone said. See, so often it's the things that people say that we begin to find our identity in. And it's those things that tell us the lie and confirm the lie in our lives that I'm not good enough. And the enemy is telling us that. And then he adds to it, and you never will be. See, often we struggle with that lie because we find our identity in what people say. And then for some, it's that we find our identity from past experiences. What happened in my life, something that I did or something that someone else did, because maybe it was that you grew up in a family environment where you look and go, man, nobody was successful in my family. Why would I be? Why would I be any different? This was part of the way my family is. Or maybe you go, man, I was never really loved. I mean, I never really experienced real love. And maybe that's because I'm not lovable. I'm just not good enough. Or maybe you didn't excel in school, so you decided, you know what, I just must not be smart. Or maybe it's that you had a bad decision or a series of bad decisions, and you begin to believe, well, that's just who I am. I can't change that. And you began to find your identity in those decisions, and you just decided that just must be who you are. I'm not good enough because of these things. Maybe it's that you had a failed marriage or a failed business, and the enemy says, see, you're a failure. You're not good enough. And you struggle often because you find your identity in these past experiences. For some, it's the tragedy that thousands of children are molested every year, and that causes not just physical pain, but emotional pain and emotional scars. And unfortunately, those innocent victims often grow up thinking, well, that's my fault. There's something wrong with me. It happened to me because I did something wrong, because I'm not good enough. And the problem is these false beliefs form a false identity. A false identity that the enemy wants us to believe. Because he knows that if we can believe this false identity, we'll never experience the fullness that God has for us. See, what we do without meaning to is we begin to accept the lie and make an agreement with the enemy and allow it to have power in our lives. And it becomes a filter through which we see everything else, through which we hear truth, through which we see what we can or can't do. Because we allow that false belief to form a false identity, and it keeps us from believing who God says that we are and what God created us for. And it'll keep us from stepping into his purpose for our lives, because what we believe to be true will influence what we do. Whether it's true or not, what we believe to be true, if we believe it to be true, it will impact what we do in our lives. So if we believe a lie, we will allow that lie to determine who we are and what we can or can't do. You know what? We're not the first to struggle with this, though. We see this throughout Scripture. I want to look at one of those guys that we see this with. It's Moses, and you see his story in Exodus, the very beginning of Exodus. Moses was called by God to deliver the Israelites out of oppressive slavery. But when we first see Moses and see his story, we see that God spared his life as a baby, that the king of Egypt heard that this baby was going to be born that was going to deliver God's people. And so he said, all right, all the babies will be killed, but God spared Moses' life. And he ended up being raised by a daughter of the king in the palace. And so God spared him. And one day he's walking around, he sees an Egyptian slave driver harshly just beating one of the Israelite slaves. And he decides to intervene and he kills the guy. He murders the guy and he hides his body thinking, hey, maybe I can get away with it. But unfortunately, word got out what happened. And so he goes on a run and he goes into hiding. And when we see his story begin with God, when we see him have this conversation with God face to face, he's a shepherd for his father-in-law out in the desert. God comes to him through this burning bush that looked like it was burning, but it wasn't being consumed by the fire. And God says, hey, I want you to go and deliver my people out of Egypt. I've heard their cry, and I'm sending you. And he goes, no, you've got the wrong guy, God. Don't you know what happened in the past? Don't you know what they say about me back there? There's no way. You've got the wrong guy. God was saying, I want you to be a deliverer. And he said, there's no way I'm a deliverer. I'm defective. I'm not good enough. I've messed up too much. There's no way they'll listen to me. And not only that, I can't even talk well. I'm bad at talking. And so God begins to speak truth into Moses' life. But even with that, this voice of inadequacy speaks even louder. Look at it with me in Exodus. It says, then the Lord asked Moses, who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether people speak or do not speak, hear or do not hear, see or do not see? Is it not I, the Lord? You're saying that your speech is a problem? It's not a problem for me. I'm the one who controls that, remember? And then he says, now go. I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say. Now, you would think at this point, Moses would be like, all right, God, you got this. I'll trust you on this. We'll give it a go. You did. You created my mouth. You created words. And if you're going to go with me, then I'm in. But that's not what Moses says. Moses again pleaded, Lord, please send anyone else. And what he's saying is, God, you have the wrong guy. I can't do what you're asking me to do. I'm not the wrong guy, please send anyone else. You see, because what he believed to be true impacted what he thought he could do. He bought into a lie about his identity, about who God made him to be and what God could do in him and through him. And so because of that, he was resistant to step into God's purpose and plan for his life. And it was a lie that led to false conclusions of, I'm not good enough. I'm only going to fail. I'm inadequate in every way. I can't do it. Listen, I know the enemy tries to say the same thing to you and the same thing to me all the time. And I want you to know this today, that you are not defined by what others say or by the sum total of your past experiences. You are not defined by the opinions of other people or what happened to you in your past. You are who God says you are, who he created you to be, and he gets to define your identity and your worth, and only him. So when the enemy begins to try to tell you you're someone else, you've got to begin to recognize the lie and say, that's not who I am. I'm not defined by that. Not only that, if you've put your faith in Christ, God tells us that you're a new person. He used a guy named Paul to say it this way in his letter to the Corinthians, that this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. Anyone who's admitted that they've sinned, and we all have, believed that Jesus died for us and that he rose from the grave and said, man, I put my faith in Jesus, that you're a new person. He says the old life is gone and a new life has begun, that there's this great exchange between the old and the new. And I want us to consider who's saying this. This is a guy that when we first read about him in Scripture, he hated Christians. He was trying to wipe them out. He approved of them being killed and them being beaten and tortured. And then he experienced God for himself. And then God used him to write much of the New Testament Scripture and used him to start many of the early churches that we read about today. And I love this because in a way he's saying, listen, look what God's done in my life. The old is gone and now I have a new life. And if God can do that with me, he can do that with anyone. You're a new person. See, he understood the old was gone, and he tells us, anyone who belongs to Christ, you've become a new person. And listen, anyone can belong to Christ. That's the reason Jesus came. Jesus came because we all sin, and our sin has broken our relationship with God and led to a very broken world and broken life in so many ways. And there was nothing we could do to fix what sin broke. And so God sent his son to fix what our sin broke. Jesus lived a perfect life. He walked the earth. Then he died on the cross for claiming to be the one that God sent to take away the sins of mankind. And he rose from the grave on the third day. He was seen by over 500 eyewitnesses so that anybody who would repent and believe in him could be saved. The old could be gone, and he could receive the new in our new relationship through Jesus Christ. It's a choice of saying, man, God, I see that I've messed up. I believe Jesus made a way, and I want to trust him completely with my life. And when you do, God gives you the Holy Spirit to do a work in us and through us to help us live a new life. So God made us new. He makes us new through our relationship with Christ. But the problem is we have to learn to live the new way. If you've ever coached a kid and trying to teach them how to throw a baseball or a football the right way, the reality is if they've been throwing an old way and the wrong way for a while, it doesn't take just one time of showing them to fix it, does it? It takes repetition over and over. And the reality is we need the same kind of repetition if we're going to begin to learn to live the new life that God has for us, because those old memories don't go away. It's God's truth that begins to change the way we think. And so today I want to look at some truths that combat this lie. I'm not good enough. Some truths that God gives us in Scripture that when the enemy brings this lie to our front, we can say, no. Here's what God says. Here's what is true, and allow God's truth to change the way we think. The first truth we see is in 1 Peter 5. Peter was one of Jesus' closest followers, and God used him to write this, that in his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. He called you. He called you. He called me. And he says this, so after a little while, after you've suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. He's saying, listen, he called you, and it doesn't mean life is always going to be easy, but what he is saying is that regardless of the ups and downs, that this new relationship is a firm foundation you can build your life on. Now, I think the first truth we need to understand is that you are called. You are called by the Son of the living God. He called you himself. When I was working at a church several years ago, it was a rather large church, and I was a student pastor, and there was a lot of people between me and the senior pastor. And so I didn't have a lot of contact with them, and that was fine. It was just the way the structure was. But one day I got this call from an unknown number, and I just assumed it was a telemarketer. And so I slipped into, you know, a little bit of a personality that I have sometimes when answering those phone calls. Something like, well, hello, who do I have the pleasure of speaking with today? And the voice on the other side, is this Duke? And it was my senior pastor calling. His voice was very, very recognizable in that moment. I got super nervous and started saying, this is Chris, this is Duke. That's my middle name. And I stuttered out throughout the rest of the conversation. Now, here's the thing. I never imagined he would ever call me. I didn't even know he had my number because he was so much higher in the organization. I didn't know why he would ever call me. And I think sometimes we don't think that the God of the universe would ever call us. And he's telling you and he's telling me, I called you by name. I called you to myself. And I want you to have a firm foundation to build your identity on. Listen, he says to you, if you are tired and you are worn out from trying to find your identity in just being enough and trying to prove you are enough, he says, come to me, you who are tired and weary and worn out, and I will give you rest. He says, listen, those who are tired of searching for meaning and purpose and feel like there must be more to life, he's saying, come to me, and I'm living water. I will quench your thirst. I'm the bread of life. I will satisfy you like nothing else can, because I am the only way to full and satisfying life. And he calls you, and he calls me, and says, that's the firm foundation you can build your life on. You are called. Another truth that we see here in 1 Peter chapter 2 says, God says this through Peter, but you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. You are chosen. And then he says, as a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. The second truth we need to hold on to is that you are chosen. You are chosen by God. Have you ever been part of the choosing of teams, right? And you weren't the person choosing the teams. You were the one waiting to be chosen. When I was working at a church there in Plano, they had some nice basketball courts, and a lot of the staff would gather and play after work. And a lot of the staff, they were all tall and played a lot of basketball because they were tall. And so I would go and I'd play with them, and they always said that I played basketball like a fullback, which I'll take that. That just meant I was aggressive and I hurt their feelings, all right? And so we played basketball a little bit, but I had a friend of mine who called me one day. He's actually my best friend on staff. He said, "Hey, dude, come play basketball today. We need one more." And so I was like, "What does that mean? I'm the last call? All right, that's fine. I'll come. So I came and I got there, and they began picking teams. And my friend, my one who called me, was one of the ones picking teams. And he didn't pick me. And I was highly offended and hurt. And later in the game, I fouled him rather hard. And I truly believe it was because the enemy was saying to me, using that to say to me, your own friend won't even pick you. You aren't good enough. Isn't it crazy how the enemy will use the silliest of things to try to reinforce his lies? See, I think in life there are many moments where we feel overlooked or rejected or not picked. And God's telling us through Peter, you are good enough. God picked you for himself. You are chosen. And he personally calls you out of spiritual darkness and into spiritual light, new light. And he wants you to experience that new light for yourself and shine it for others to see. You are called and you are chosen. Another truth that we see in scriptures is in a letter that God used Paul to write to the Philippians. He said, "For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength." Now that verse is in a lot of weight rooms and locker rooms, but it has nothing to do with athletics, all right? It actually, Paul's writing this from prison, where he's been locked up for sharing the gospel. And he's saying, "Hey, guys, despite these terrible circumstances, God has given me the strength to be all he created me to be and to continue to do what he created me to do." That here's what he's saying to me and he's saying to you. Regardless of your circumstances, the ups and downs, that you are capable. You're not capable because of your own strength. You're capable because of God's strength in you and through you. Saying you are capable, because your enemy's greatest desire is to convince you, well, you can't do that. You're not good enough. You can't do what God called you to do, because there will be ups and there will be downs and there will be things the enemy tries to use in our life to say, "See, you tried and you failed. That's because you're not good enough." And God's saying, it's not true. You're living in a broken world, but despite all these things, God has given you everything you need to overcome. I love the way God says it through Paul in his letter to the Romans when he says, "No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us." He's saying, listen, you are not the victim of your circumstances. Despite all these things, you are more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. He won it for us. And we get to share in his victory. Now, there's been so many times in ministry where I was ready to throw in the towel. We'd have a big, student event, and maybe something didn't go exactly the way I wanted to do it to, or there was a message that fell flat. And I can't tell you how many times I drove home time and time and time again going, "God, why am I doing this? I can't do this. There are so many other people who are so much better than this. Why did you call me? Will you let me go do something else? I just need to quit." And time again, God said, "You're listening to the wrong voice." He said, "It's not true. You're more than capable, not because of you, but because of me in you and through you. And I had to learn I'm not capable in my own strength, but I am capable of everything God's called me to do when I learn to rely on his strength and not my own. And I know so often sometimes we struggle because we rely on our own strength. Maybe you're struggling in marriage and you're going, man, I don't know that I can ever make my spouse happy. And you know what? Maybe you can't. They may be a moving target. But here's what I do know, that God can in you, that Christ can in you and through you, that he can give you a marriage far greater than you could have ever imagined, but you're going to have to die to self and learn to serve selflessly, serve with no expectations. And I know you're going, really, no expectations? Yeah, Jesus, that's the way he served us. And that we would just learn to serve the way Jesus did, rely on his strength and his example. Maybe it's that you struggle with your finances because you just can't seem to get them lined out, and you've tried things. You've tried all sorts of things. And maybe it's time to just, God's going, hey, listen, why don't you try my way? Why don't you learn to rely on me instead of yourself, instead of these systems? Why don't you learn to rely on me and understand that I want you to give me the first and the best and trust that I can do more with what's left than you can do with the whole? Maybe he's saying, hey, listen, I want you to stop chasing your identity in stuff and in possessions and stop trying to finance your identity and trust me instead. Find your value and worth in me. And maybe as a parent, you're struggling because you're looking around and you feel like, man, I'm just not a very good parent. There's other people who are so much better. I'm always a step behind. I'm always feel like I'm coming apart. And maybe he's telling you, listen, stop relying on your own strength to try to be like everyone else and letting social media be your standard. Instead, let the truth of God's word tell you how to parent and trust him that it's enough, because it is. It's enough. And with his power at work in you and through you, you are enough. You are enough. We are capable of all that God's called us to do, not in our own strength, but when we learn to rely on his strength at work in us. I love the way God said it through Paul in Philippians chapter 2. He said, for God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. I love this verse because so often I have the desire, but the enemy tries to convince me I'm not capable. And God's going, no. The same power at work in you giving you the desire is the same power at work giving you the ability to do what I've created you to do. It's the Holy Spirit's power that when you put your faith in him, God gives you his Holy Spirit to help work in you and through you and work through your weaknesses, that he is strong when we are weak. And when we learn to align our lives with his power, we're able to live out what God created us for. So you are called, you are chosen, you are capable. And another truth that we see in 2 Peter 1, it says this, by his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. Everything we need. He says, we've received all of this by coming to know him through our relationship with Jesus, the one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. Listen, you are complete in Christ. He's the one who completes us. You have everything you need in your relationship with Christ. When I was in high school, there was a very popular movie that came out, and it was popular in the rom-com genre. It was about a sports agent who was trying to land a big contract for an athlete, and at the same time trying to navigate a complicated relationship. And I don't recommend the movie. It's not clean by any means. But it became popular because of this scene where Tom Cruise walks into a room full of girls and they all hate him because he's messed up the relationship somehow, some way. And he goes into this long speech where at the end they're all crying and boo-hoo, and he says, you complete me. And all the girls are crying, and she responds with, you had me at hello, right? And that became the thing, right? And here's the problem, is that many of us bought into that same lie, that there's someone out there that completes us. And if we believe that, we will go from person to person to person, because the only one who completes us is Jesus Christ. You are complete in Christ. No person can completely. No amount of success can complete you. You are not complete because of success. I was watching the Johnny Manziel documentary that just came out, and there's something that he said that just stuck out to me. He said, I had every single thing I thought I could ever want it. I had money, I had fame, I was a first-round draft pick, I was a starting quarterback of an NFL franchise. And then he said this. He says, when I got everything that I wanted, I think I was the most empty that I've ever felt inside. So if you think that I can just get enough money, I can just get enough success, it'll be good, Johnny would tell you it didn't work for him. Because no amount of success will ever satisfy. It will just leave you feeling empty because only Christ completes us. You're only made complete in Christ. God said it this way through Paul in his letter to the Colossians. He says, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. He says, so you also are complete through your union with Christ, who is the head over every ruler and authority. He says, you are complete in Christ. And this word that they use in the Greek for complete, it often referred to a ship that was ready for voyage. It had this ship, meaning that it has everything it needs to get to its next destination. And what he's saying is that in Christ, you have everything you need to get to God's destination for your life, to be who God created you to be and designed you to be. You are called, you are chosen, you are capable, and you are complete in Christ. So when the enemy begins to try to use what people say or your past experiences or something that happened, a decision you made, and tries to convince you you're not good enough, it's time for us to turn around and use the truth that God has given us to change the way we think and say, no, that's not true. I am called. I am chosen. I am capable, and I am complete in Christ. And for some of you today, you need to write that down on a card and put it where you're going to see it every day, because the enemy's been lying to you for far too long, and it's time for you to begin to use God's truth, combat the lie, so you can experience his identity in your life. The team is going to put out some graphics on social media today. You can capture those and put those as your phone screensaver, whatever you need to do. But each day, many of you need to be reminded and you need to say it out loud. I am chosen. I am called. I am capable. I am complete in Christ. Maybe for some, you need to just take some of the verses that we went over today and write them out and put them where you're going to see them every day and allow God's truth to change the way you think. Because what you believe to be true will impact what you do. He's made you. You're called. You're chosen. You're capable. You're complete in Christ. Maybe for some today, you just need to simply respond to God's call. He's calling you out of darkness into light. And listen, all you have to do to receive this new relationship, the new life, is to admit that you've sinned and we've all sinned. Believe that Jesus died on the cross to pay the penalty of our sin and that he rose from the grave. And then come to a place where you say, I don't want to live life my way anymore. I want to follow God's way. I want to trust him with my life. Maybe today that's the step you need to take. And I want to lead you in a prayer in just a second. The prayer doesn't save you. What saves you is you being honest with God. And then your next step is go public with your faith through baptism. And for the rest of us, maybe today it's just simply saying, God, will you expose the lie that I've believed? And will you help me begin to believe the truth? Will you bow your heads and close your eyes? And today if you say, I need to put my faith in Jesus to save me, tell him something like this right where you are. God, I know that I've sinned. I believe Jesus died on the cross for me to pay my penalty. And he rose from the grave. Today I put my faith in you. I trust you with my life. I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit, that you would change me from the inside out, and help me follow you the rest of my life. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. God, my prayer, Father, is that those of us who put our faith in you, that we would learn to walk in the new life that you've given us. And we do it as we allow your truth to change the way we think. We give you all the praise and all the glory because it belongs to you. Pray this in Jesus' name.
All right. Thank you, Chris. What a great message. What a way to kick off this series on identity. Hey, I just wanted to share this with you. I know how much this matters because for me, probably it's about 5 or 6 years ago, I don't remember exactly, I just kind of hit a crisis point in my life is what I would say. Now, nobody knew it on the outside, but internally, I was miserable. I felt like Johnny Manziel. Although I didn't make the money he made or score the touchdowns he scored, I felt the same way. I was like, man, I felt empty. And that's sad to say. And so I began to cry out to God, talk to God, and what I told God was I said, hey, this cannot be the abundant life. And God, you say that you sent Jesus so that we could have abundant life or life overflowing. And I said, God, I know you're too good of a God for this to be the abundant life. And so I started asking God, will you teach me what the abundant life is? Will you do that for me? Will you show me what I need to know? And guess what God started talking to me about? Identity. And he started to show me, Mark, you're getting your identity from all the wrong things, all the wrong places, all the wrong people, and you've never come to me and asked me, who do I say you are? And when I began to do that, it changed me. It absolutely transformed me. So the stuff that Chris is teaching, and I don't know who all is teaching in the series, but this series is a transformational series. So I hope you took good notes. I hope you'll go back and listen to it. And I hope you'll make an effort to be here for every one of the messages in this series. It's that important. All right, well, a couple things before you head out today. On your way out the doors, right here as you head out on the left, you'll see the new yard signs that we've printed and have available for you for free. And so we would love for you to take one of those signs. If you have one of the old ones that's now, you know, used to be red and now it's pink or it's white and red striped or whatever it has become, those need to be replaced, okay? And so we want you to take a new one, replace your old one, or maybe you've never grabbed one before. We'd love for you to take one of those and stick that in your yard at home, or if you own a business, stick it there in the yard at the business. And Chris doesn't like me saying this, but if you pass one every day and they just leave it up, feel like you ought to stop, cut that one down, and put a new one up. We have good attorneys here, so don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. Chris is just saying it's all your fault now, Mark. Okay. I've got a good attorney. That's good. All right. No, really, don't do that without permission, okay? But we want you to put up new yard signs and just let people know about our church. It's a great way to invite and let them know how much you love your church. So we'd love that. Also, groups. We are currently signing people up for groups. We're going to have a big group kickoff. So these are small groups, which we call life groups here at Grace Fellowship Church. And we would love for everybody to take this step and to get into a small group, a life group, where you can begin to get to know some other people in a much closer way. It's hard in a room like this, right, to just meet a few people and begin to build strong relationships, and life groups allow you to do that. And at the same time, you can grow in your relationship with God because you can help other people grow, and they can help you grow as you begin to share what God's doing in your life. So it's a really, really important thing, a really great thing, and we would love for everybody to be in one. So as you head out today, you'll see the sign over there by the front window, and it says group up. And you can go right over there, let them know what you're interested in, and they'll help you get connected to a group. Or you can scan that QR code, and one of the links there is get in a group. You can click on that, give your information, and somebody will follow up with you and get you into a life group. So we'd love for you to do that on the way out. Well, our prayer partners are heading forward right now, and they will be right down here at the front. If you have anything for which you need prayer, whether that be for you or someone you know, a situation in your life, whatever, or maybe you prayed and placed your faith in Jesus today, it'd be great for you to come and talk to them about that also. Well, we are finished today. Thank you so much for being here. We'll see you back next week, and bring somebody with you. See you then.